Father, as we come to you this morning, Lord, we just thank you so much for your love, Lord, and we just thank you for the lesson this morning. Lord, we just ask you, Lord, to be with our speaker this morning, Lord, as he comes and shares your word. And Lord, I thank you so much for this time that we have, that we can listen to him, Father. And Lord, for Brother Waylon, as he brings our song service and others that sings, Father, we just ask that you help us to prepare our hearts for your word. And Lord, be with those that's being baptized this morning, Lord, and we just ask that you help us to line up beside them, Father, and Lord, just lead them and help them to grow closer to you. Thank you again for loving us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Good morning. Just a couple of announcements. Y'all be praying in earnest for our youth this week. They leaving in the morning, and that's the first major accomplishment if they can get up at 7 o'clock and be here. I mean, I already seen one's jaw drop. 7 o'clock? And then, you know, it's not just the youth. We got to worry about I don't know if he can make it that early. But be praying for them this week while they go on the youth camp. We may have to get a freight liner to go along. I talked to one young lady. She's packing for 5 days. She got 3 suitcases. Just like a woman. All you need is a Walmart bag. But, all right. Y'all pray for those. We got the evangelism training today. We're going to have that this evening. I was asked to say that Miss Kathy has all the refreshments. That's all under control. We don't need to bring anything. So we'll start at 5 o'clock. 5 o'clock. And then we'll somewhere in there we'll have a break. And then we'll come back and go till about 7. So please be here for that. I know we'll enjoy it. I know we need to hear it. So the Young at Heart Tuesday has been canceled. Miss Alter's gonna be tied up. She's gonna have surgery, cataract surgery, nothing major, but still, she won't be able to pull this off. So that's about all I wanted to say.
Tomorrow night?
Tomorrow night we'll meet here for prayer time, right? Yeah, that's what we're going to do. But I was just making sure he didn't have something else. But tomorrow night we're going to meet here for prayer time. We'd love to have y'all come join with us. We just come to church. Gathering fellowship hall to pray for God's direction upon our church. So as he directs Brother Mike to direct us in his way and keep his focus the main thing. So come and join us for that. Brother Mike.
All right. It's always a wonderful, wonderful way to start a service with baptisms.
Amen.
To see what God's doing and changing lives and touching people's lives. And I tell you, a church that's got a baptistry that's dry rotting is a church that needs a revival. Amen? We don't have that problem here, and we're thankful for these that have come this week, these recent weeks, and made decisions to follow the Lord Jesus Christ. And today they come to follow him in the ordinance of baptism, to be obedient to God. You know, Jesus entered into the Jordan River and was baptized. And he was baptized to show his willingness to die, to be buried, and to be resurrected, and to say that we could do that too. We could follow him. And when we're baptized, we're showing publicly that we want to be in Christ and that we've given our lives to be in Christ. And so these come today making that public profession. I mentioned Jesus getting baptized. Well, some of you may not remember, but we told you that about... it's been now what, Larry, about 3 weeks ago? 3 weeks ago, we baptized 10 of our church members in the Jordan River where Jesus was baptized. And what an experience that was. And I got the opportunity to baptize them again, a symbolic act of showing that they definitely, in every possible way, want to be identified with Jesus Christ, unashamed. And that's why these come today, to show that they're not ashamed of being a follower of Jesus Christ. Miss Sue, you come. Take your time.
like the warm.
Yeah.
Feel funny coming in here with the clothes on.
Yeah. This is Miss Sue Calhoun. She came forward last Sunday morning during our invitation, and she said, "Brother Mike, I'm not saved." And she said, "I want to be saved." And so guess what? We have a Lord that says, "Whosoever will may come." Amen. And Miss Sue, that whosoever will includes you and me. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
And have you asked Jesus to come into your heart?
Yes, I did.
Amen. You believe you did that, don't you?
Yes, I did.
Amen. So today, my sister, it's a privilege for me to be able to baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Hold your nose now with your hand. We're buried with Christ and raised to walk in a new life. God bless.
Good. Good.
Was that you came over the other day and talked to me? Was that, what day was that?
I'm not sure.
You're not sure, huh? Last Sunday night, as y'all know, can't see her? All right, stand up. Stand up there, baby. All right. This is Bella Rodriguez. She's my granddaughter. I baptized her a few years ago. She said she came in and talked to me last Sunday evening when, you know, after we got home after our little fellowship up here. And she said, "Bob, that's my name." She said, "I got baptized a few years ago." She said, "But I need to be saved."
Amen.
And we talked and talked about that and felt like she followed her brother down the aisle. And this was going to be her decision. And so Bella kind of nailed down her salvation last Sunday night at the house and wants to follow the Lord in baptism here today. You've asked Christ to come into your heart.
Yes, sir.
Forgive your sins.
Yes, sir.
Amen. Bella, not only is my granddaughter, I get to baptize you as my sister in Christ. In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, we're buried with Christ and raised to walk in a new life. Amen. Come on, David. That baptism right there with my granddaughter is one of those great ones that you never forget. But this one right here may be one of the greatest ones I'll ever remember, right here. I grew up with this guy. I grew up with David. And David and I, like I say, we've been a lot of places and vacationed sometimes together and out of high school and just a friend. But his sister Valerie, is she here today?
Yes.
There she is back there. She heard David was making the public decision to follow Christ today and she wanted to be here. Folks, let me tell you something. God can save anybody if he can save old David. Amen. And if he can save me, if he can save you, he can save anybody. And I don't care who you are. God loves you. He's got a wonderful plan for your life.
Yeah.
David and I and Gary Lively back there and old Daniel. Daniel's gone working this week, but we grew up together. And I just never dreamed that we'd be this point in our lives and going to church together, following Christ. And these guys said it's getting late in their life. It's time to get some things settled. Is that right, David?
That's right.
You ask Christ to come into your life?
Yes.
Give your sins. Well, David, it's a great privilege and honor to baptize you now, my brother in Christ. In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, we're buried with Christ, raised to walk in a new life. Amen. Amen. God bless you, brother.
Yes, sir.
I love that guy right there. He always gave me a hard time about my hair falling out early. He knew I was going to lose my hair early. Well, it's good to see that he's losing his hair now. Amen. It's good to see. Come on down here, Gabby. You can just remain standing so they can see you, okay? This is Gabby Simpson. I go through the whole family back there. Her grandparents are David and Linda Williams, and we see Shane back there, and Miss Haley, her mom. Here's Haley up here. And I've known this family for a lot of years. And today, Gabby, well, actually about two or three years ago during COVID, Gabby, you asked Jesus to come into your heart?
Yes, sir.
And forgive your sins?
Yes, sir.
She assured me she did that, but she never got around to following through in believer's baptism. And her baby sister got saved last week at Seeker Springs and confirmed all that through our vacation Bible school. And we were going to baptize her, and Gabby said she's ready. You ready to make your decision public, Gabby? Be identified with Jesus. So my sister, I now call you. I baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. We're buried with Christ, ready to walk in a new life. God bless you, Gabby. Come on down here, Bella. Got another Bella here. Just stand right up there, Bella. There she is. Bella, did you pray and ask Jesus to come into your heart? Forgive your sins? Amen. You're not ashamed of that, are you? And you want to be baptized today like Jesus, huh? Well, I tell you what, I'm going to say to Mama and Daddy and Grandpa and all of you, I look forward to getting to train y'all of how to follow Jesus and how to be a disciple of Jesus, okay? And be like Him. So I baptize you now as my sister. Did you know that? And I do that in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. We're buried with Christ, raised to walk in a new life. Amen. 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 People say, how old do you have to be to get saved? You have to be old enough to understand that you're a sinner and only Jesus can save you. And you come with childlike faith. You don't come with a PhD. You come with childlike faith that believes that Jesus is the only way. I don't know what that age is. It varies from child to child. But I know a God who says, forsake not the little children to come unto me. And when they come and they have a desire in their heart to give their heart to Christ, they may be like my little Bella. They may come back in a few years and nail it down, get it right. But for now, I want them to go to sleep at night, feeling like they've made peace with God and done what God's asked them to do. Brother Whalen, you come and lead us.
If you are going on the youth trip as a student or an adult, would you come down for us, please? Mr. Todd's we're gonna have a time of praying for those.
There we go. Good morning, church family. Thank y'all so much for being here this morning. That's just a beautiful picture of Christ right there. Redemption. Amen. Y'all, we just wanna this is our youth coming. They're going to camp this week, and what an honor it is. To bask in the glory of God. We're going to have a great time and learn more about our walk with Christ. And we just want to pray over them this morning. And we just ask that y'all join in with us this morning, okay? Dear Heavenly Father, we come to you this morning, God. We just thank you so much for Christ, God. Thank you for sending him to the cross for our sins, Father. God, we just lift up this week coming up. Go before us, Father, God. God, if there's one that doesn't know you as their Lord and personal Savior, Father, I pray that they make that decision this week, Father. And pray that they continue on the path to following Christ, God, to take up their cross daily, Father, as we all Christians, all believers do, Father. God, I pray for the other churches. I pray for the other youth that are coming from other churches, God. If there's any there that, God, that they don't know Christ, Father, that they make that decision, God. Ones that may do know you, Father, that just need renewing in their soul, Father, God, I pray they make that decision too, Father. God, may we just have a joyful time, God, in the name of Christ. And we lift all this up to you in the name of Jesus. Amen. Thank y'all.
Amen. All right, let's stand together. That's the only time I'm going to say stand together. I'm going to leave it totally up to y'all. If you want to remain seated, if you want to sit somewhere in the middle, you want to get up and get down. Wait a minute. I don't know if we want to get up and get down, but anyway, yeah, we'll deal with that. Let's all sing together.
We have heard the joyful sound. Jesus saves, Jesus saves. Spread the tidings all around. Jesus saves, Jesus saves. Tell the news to every man. Find the love and cross the ways. Onward is our Lord demands. Jesus saves, Jesus saves. Sing above the battle strife. Revealing Jesus.
How great the chasm that lies between us. How high the mountain I could not climb. In desperation, I turned to heaven and spoke your name into the night. Then through the darkness, your loving kindness tore through the shadows of my soul. The work is finished, the end is written. Jesus Christ, my living hope. Who could imagine so great a mercy? What heart could fathom such boundless grace? The God of ages stepped down from glory to wear my sin and bear my shame. The cross has spoken, I am forgiven. The King of Kings calls me his own. Beautiful Savior, I'm yours forever. Jesus Christ, my living hope.
Hallelujah. Praise the one who set me free. Hallelujah. Death has lost its grip on me. You have broken every chain. There's salvation in your name, Jesus Christ, my living hope. Hallelujah. Praise the one who set me free. Hallelujah. Death has lost its grip on me. You have broken every chain. There's salvation in your name. Buried by
in the morning when I rise.
In the morning when I rise. In the morning when I rise. Give me Jesus. Give me Jesus. Give me.
proclaiming the good news, winning families to Jesus all around his neighborhood. He tells them that God is able to make his house a home. He wants to win his world for Christ, but he can't do it alone. But each one can reach one as we follow after Christ. We all can lead one. We can lead one to the Savior, and together we can tell the world that Jesus is the way. If we each one reach one, the message is unchanging. Go ye into all the world and share the love of Jesus. Far away, your door. You see, just like somebody told you that Jesus loves you so, you must tell someone who will tell someone until the whole world knows. Each one can reach one.
Children's church at this time, and the workers go with them too. Workers, we don't want them going by themselves. All right, Miss Lisa, you in charge back there today?
Yes, sir.
That's kind of scary. All right, we are blessed to have with us today a young man named Preston Condra. I don't know how young he is anymore, but he used to be real young. Preston and his wife do a ministry together. I don't know the full name you told me recently, but he's going to share all that information with you. But one of the things that he does, he travels around and he does these workshops and shares in churches about how to share your faith in a very simple way that should not be frightening to anyone, shouldn't be challenging to anyone. And we've asked him to come today and to share with us. He's sharing with a lot of other churches in our area, some in the next couple of weeks. And
working with our association. And I just think we need to, this is one area that as we, as times get darker out there, maybe in the world, we have to be able to share our faith one-on-one with people that we know. And I'm excited that he's here with us today. He and his wife have written some books, produced some books. He's graduate of Southwestern Seminary and been on church staffs in different places, Oklahoma and Arkansas. And so today, if you would welcome with me today, our guest who will be back tonight at 5 o'clock. We didn't clarify probably earlier, but we want to meet over in the fellowship hall, the new fellowship hall tonight. And we're going to meet over there from 5 to 7 for a workshop where we'll be actually be practicing some of the things that he's going to talk to us about. Preston, you come today. Thank you for being with us.
Oh, thank you. Lost my microphone there. Thank you. Let me get that. Thank you very much. Good morning. How's everybody this morning? Let me get myself situated here and we'll get going. If you have your Bible, look in 1 Corinthians chapter 15. 1 Corinthians 15 is where we're going to be, verses 1 through 4. We'll look at a couple other verses too, but that's where we're going to spend the most of our time. 1 Corinthians 15, 1 through 4. As you're turning there, let me tell you about our ministry. Our ministry is called Sufficient Word Ministries. We're based out of Springdale, Arkansas. Okay? Don't hold that against me, though, all right? When I'm not cheering for the Hogs, I am cheering for LSU, just so you know. Especially when you play Alabama, right? Anyway, our ministry is a writing and teaching ministry based out of Springdale, and so what we seek to do is produce materials, hopefully, that you can use that will help you mature in your faith, but also help you share your faith. In fact, we'll be talking about some of those, one of those books this evening I'll tell you about. And if you want to look us up on the web, our website is, you can write it down, look at it later, www.666, don't go there. I don't know what's there. Go to sufficientword.com. You can go there and get in touch with us there. If you want to send us an email from that website, you can do that. We'll be glad to help you in any way that we can. We are also on Facebook. If you're a Facebook person, check us out on Facebook, facebook.com/sufficientword. We post regularly on there if you'd like to keep up with us there. And also, here's some of our books if you'd be interested in something that will help you. I've got these available on the table out in the foyer as well. They'll be available tonight. But the book we're going to really spend time on is part of the series of books that we produce for the Louisiana Baptist Convention that we want to help you to share your faith. And the book we'll look at this morning is a handbook for helping you share your faith with confidence. And here's the three fears we're going to solve today. And here's what our training does, what our books do. And think about yourself when it comes to witnessing. Have you ever had these three fears? I don't know what to say. How many of you have had that fear before? Okay. How about this one? I would like to witness more, but I'm afraid I'm going to offend someone or make someone mad. How many of you have had that one? How about this one? I'm afraid I can't answer objections or questions about the gospel. How many of you have had we're going to solve all three of those today, okay? In fact, we're going to solve that first one, at least the biggest part of that first one this morning, as we look at the gospel passage in 1 Corinthians 15, 1 through 4. I'll tell you why I call that the gospel passage. You'll see it in just a moment as we look at it. But turn there, 1 Corinthians 15, 1 through 4. If you have your Bible, if you have it on your device, look at it. I want you to see it yourself. Okay? 1 Corinthians 15, 1 through 4. Hold your finger there because we're going to also go over to Romans chapter 1, verse 16. All right? So 1 Corinthians 15, 1 through 4, and then we're going to look at Romans chapter 1, verse 16. Look what the Apostle Paul says here, speaking to the church at Corinth, the believers he's talking to. He says, "Moreover, brethren, I declare unto you the gospel." That's why I call it the gospel passage right there. He says the gospel. Okay, actually, Paul labels it that. Here he tells us what he's talking about here. "Which I preached unto you." So this is the gospel that the apostles preached. "Which also you have received." We'll come back to that "received" in just a minute. "And wherein you stand." Look at verse 2. "By which also you are saved. If you underline in, if you write in your Bible, underline that. It's very important. This is the gospel by which you were saved, Paul is saying. It's a saving message. If you keep in memory what I preached unto you, unless you have believed in vain. We'll come back to those statements in just a minute. Verse 3, for I delivered unto you first of all that which I also received. Here it is. Here is the saving gospel message right here. How that Christ died for our sins according to the Scriptures, and that He was buried, and that He rose again the third day according to the Scriptures. That is the gospel message right there. In fact, when we talk about preaching the gospel, when we talk about sharing the gospel, this is what we're talking about here. Did you know that this is the only place in the Bible right here in 1 Corinthians 15, 1 through 4, where the gospel is called the gospel and it's fully presented in one passage? This is the only place. We've got all kinds of other verses about different aspects of the gospel message here, but God, in His infinite wisdom, has given us the gospel right here in a short verse and a half. Isn't that great? And what do we draw from that? The gospel's a simple message, isn't it? That Christ died for our sins according to the Scriptures. He was buried, and on the third day He rose from the dead. Do you know the solution to that first fear, I don't know what to say, in witnessing, is that you know the gospel, right? That's the message that we are to proclaim to the unbelieving world. This is the message anyone who wants to be saved must believe for the purpose of salvation in order to have the forgiveness of sins. That Christ died for our sins according to the Scriptures, and that He was buried, and that He rose again the third day according to the Scriptures. Look over in Romans 1:16. I mentioned that a minute ago. Let's look at that. Paul gives us a little more information on this passage that we just read in 1 Corinthians 15. This is a familiar verse to you, I'm sure. Romans 1:16 says, for I am not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, for it, when he says it, what's he referring back to? The gospel of Christ, right? For it, the gospel of Christ, is the power of God unto salvation to everyone. Now, if we stop there, that would mean everyone goes to heaven, right? It's a doctrine, a false doctrine called universalism. But it doesn't stop there, does it? Look what he goes on to say. To everyone that what? Believes. To everyone that believes what? The gospel of Christ. It. It is the power of God unto salvation to everyone that believes it, is the implication there. And in case there's any question what he means by everyone, look what he says. To the Jew first and also to the Greek. Does that mean just to Jews and Greeks? No, it means to the Jew and the non-Jew. That's everybody. Everyone who will believe this message for the purpose of salvation, that Jesus died for our sins according to the Scriptures, and that He was buried, and that He rose again the third day, whoever will believe that that's enough for the forgiveness of sins all by itself will have the power of God unto salvation. Now, as Americans, that sounds awfully simple, doesn't it? You mean I don't have to do anything? That's right. In fact, there's nothing you can do that would ever gain you God's favor. He's done it all in what Jesus did for us. And I'm telling you, it is enough. Notice the three things Romans 1:16 tells us. He gives us the name of that saving gospel we just read about in 1 Corinthians 15, 1 through 4. It's the gospel of Christ. And it is the power of God unto salvation by believing it, the gospel of Christ. Notice that leaves out everything else, doesn't it? And everyone who believes it, everyone will be saved. Doesn't matter how bad you think you are, how bad people tell you are not beyond the forgiveness of God. Thank God for that. Let's go back to 1 Corinthians 15. Look at verse 1. Brethren, I declare unto you the gospel which I preached unto you, which also you have received, and wherein you stand. You remember what that word gospel means? What does it mean? It's good news, isn't it? It's a message. It's a message to be believed. And he says, Paul tells us that this is the message of salvation that these Corinthians had received. You know what that word received means in the original? The New Testament's written in Greek. That word in the original Greek there in the New Testament means accepted. They had, by their own will, accepted this gospel message for the purpose of salvation. And he also says, not only have they accepted it, but wherein you stand. That word stand means to establish or stabilize. Paul gives us a little insight into the Christian life. Do you know, folks, that the power of the gospel is so strong that it not only delivers a person from hell, but also provides deliverance for the believer in this life so that we can walk in freedom over our three enemies, the world, the flesh, and the devil. Now, isn't that good news? That is good news. So the Corinthians had accepted this message that Paul preached to them, this gospel message, and it's believing that message that saved them, but also gave them stability. Let's go on. Look at verse 2. Believing the gospel message saves. How do we know that? Because we can read it right there in verse 2. By which also you are saved, if you keep in memory what I preached unto you, unless you have believed in vain. Verse 1 tells us that this is the gospel. Verse 2 tells us it's believing the gospel message that saves. Remember, Paul is talking to saved people, and he established that for us in verse 1 when he said that you had accepted this. And now he makes, not only does he tell us this is a saving message, but in this verse he also makes a couple of what I call qualifying statements. He says, if you keep in memory, or unless you have believed in vain. Well, let's talk about that first one, if you keep in memory. That word keep in the original actually means to hold or to grasp. It's what we might think of as grasping a concept. It's holding in memory. It's remembering, right? Here's really what that means. In fact, let me illustrate it for you this way. How many of you remember that 2 plus 2 equals 4? How many of you? Okay, most of you, not all of you. Now, listen, I got to be honest. When I ask that in Texas, nobody raises their hands. It just goes right over their head. No, you remember it. You hold it in your memory because you understand it. You understand the concept that $2 plus $2 more equals $4. That's what that means here. That they understood. Paul says this is the saving gospel message that you accepted and wherein you stand, unless you didn't understand, unless you didn't grasp it. What's the significance there? That understanding the saving gospel message is a prerequisite to believing it. Now, you don't have to be an expert on the Bible, but you do have to understand that you're a sinner. There's nothing you can do to save yourself, that Jesus died on the cross for your sins and paid the price for your sins, and all you have to do is by faith believe that what he did is sufficient by itself to give you the forgiveness of sins before God. And when you believe that, you have a right standing with God. You have the forgiveness of sins forever. And a home in heaven, you have hope. But you got to understand some things, don't you? So understanding is a prerequisite to believing it. Paul also says another thing here, unless you believed in vain. Isn't that an interesting statement? What does that mean, believe in vain, Preston? Well, I'm glad you asked. In vain there actually means without success. That's what the word in the original means. But what does that mean? Well, it happens in three ways. Believing without success happens in three ways. Got them listed for you here. You can believe with an incorrect purpose. You can believe that the gospel is insufficient to save. I'll explain these in just a second. Or you can put your faith in an incorrect object. Let's do the first one here. How does a person say they believe the gospel but with an incorrect purpose? Here's an example of how it happens. You know, most people believe that Jesus was a real person in history. Okay, even the reasonable atheists will say that Jesus was a historic person. But they will not say that he's Savior. Do you see the difference? There's a difference in assenting to the facts of who Jesus is and not believing in him as Savior, right? It's all in the purpose. So people can believe amiss, if you will, when they don't believe in Jesus as Savior and simply believe in him as a historic person. Can you see how they would say they believe in Jesus, but they don't believe in him as Savior? The second way believing in vain happens is believing that what Jesus did on the cross is not sufficient to save. It's not enough. How does that happen? When you add something to the gospel message. For instance, water baptism. There are a lot of people today who believe that, yeah, Jesus died on the cross and he rose again, and you got to believe that, but you also have to be baptized in water to be saved. In fact, some will go so far as to say, you got to be baptized in our church to be saved, right? When you add something to the gospel message, a couple of things happen. First of all, it's an admission that what Jesus did is not enough on the cross and his resurrection to give you the forgiveness of sins. Second thing is, your faith is actually in that which you add to the gospel message and not the gospel that Jesus died on the cross for your sins and was buried and rose again the third day. Do you see that? Do you see why I say the significance here with the gospel is that you believe that what Jesus did on the cross by itself is enough to give you the forgiveness of sins? You add something to it, it's an admission that it's not. I'm convinced, folks, that what Jesus did on the cross and his resurrection is enough all by itself to give you the forgiveness of sins. The question is, do you believe that? The third thing is, you can put your faith in an incorrect object. Why do we bring this up? Faith's always in something. It's not a standalone concept, right? How does an incorrect object of faith come into play when we're talking about believing in vain here? Here's how it happens. When you change or monkey with the elements of the gospel, you change the whole message. Let's say you monkey with who Jesus is, and you say he's not God, he's not the second person of the Trinity, he didn't really rise from the dead, or something like that. When you change those things, you change the whole message. And your faith all of a sudden is in a different object than the object we see, which is that Jesus died for your sins, and on the third day he rose from the dead according to the Scriptures. Do you see? Believing in vain does happen when you add something to the gospel, or when you change the gospel message itself, right? So Paul is saying, this is the gospel you accepted, wherein you stand, unless you didn't understand, or unless you believed something else, unless you believed in vain. Well, what does believing mean? Let's look at what believing means in the New Testament. Look over in Romans chapter 4. Paul gives a great instruction here for us on believing. Romans chapter 4, verse 3 says, for what does the Scripture say? Then he goes on to use Abraham as an illustration. He says, Abraham believed God, there's that word, and it was credited to him as righteousness. Skip down to verse 20. Yet with respect to the promise of God, he, Abraham, did not waver in unbelief, but grew strong in faith, giving glory to God, and being fully persuaded, my goodness, if you write in your Bible, underline that, very important, and being fully persuaded that what God had promised, he was able also to perform. Therefore, it was also credited to him as righteousness. When you see that word believe in the New Testament in the verb form, it's the Greek word pistuo. Now, I'm not a Greek scholar, I just looked it up, okay? And all that word pistuo means in the Greek, all that word faith or to believe means, when you see that in the New Testament, is to be persuaded of something. Right? It's what we would think of in our vernacular as convinced. I'm convinced that's true. That's what faith means. And notice, he really explains that for us in verse 21. He says, being fully persuaded. Why does he put that there? Because in verse 21, when he says being fully persuaded, is explaining Abraham believing God. Abraham was fully persuaded that what God said he would do, he would actually literally do. Abraham was convinced. And that's what, in relation to believing the gospel, that's what we're talking about here. When we say in order to believe that to be saved, that you are convinced that what Jesus did on the cross and his resurrection is enough by itself, it's sufficient to give you the forgiveness of sins. Right? So to actually believe the gospel means that you're persuaded that it is true because it is true. Let's look at the content of the gospel. He tells us that in verses 3 and 4. He said, "For I delivered unto you first of all that which I also received, how that Christ died for our sins according to the Scriptures, and that he was buried, and that he rose again the third day according to the Scriptures." Notice the five things he points out here. He talks about who he is, what he did, why I need it, how I get it, and where it is found. Those are the five things he mentions here. And this is what we've outlined in the book. Can I ask you a question? In fact, it's how we answer all the objections, the 40 objections to the gospel that we have in there, because this is how people would have an objection to be in one of these categories. Let's talk about the elements here for just a minute. When we say who he is, why is that pointed out here? Well, because the gospel passage tells us that in verse 3, that Christ died for our sins. So when Paul says Christ, he's talking about a specific person, the Lord Jesus Christ. Who is he? Well, here's a snapshot of who he is. He's the Old Testament prophesied Messiah who was born of the Virgin, just as the gospel accounts say, who lived a sinless life while he was on earth, who performed miracles while he was on earth, who died physically, bodily on the cross for our sins. He was buried. That proved he died. On the third day, he rose from the dead and was seen by over 500 people that day. Another proof of the resurrection, right? He's fully God and he's fully man. He's the one and only way of salvation, and he's coming back again someday. In a nutshell, that's who Jesus Christ is. And you can't monkey with any of that, change any of that, and at the same time say you believe the gospel message, because when you do that, you change the whole message, you see? Who is Jesus? Just who the Bible tells us he is. And part of accepting the gospel, folks, is accepting Christ as he is. Right? You say, well, the gospel verses don't plainly say that Jesus is God. Well, think about this for a minute. Could someone be saved who denied that Jesus was God? Let's think about this. If Jesus is just another man and not God, could a person's faith in an ordinary man save him? That's really the question. No. If Jesus was just another man, just an ordinary man, he would need saving himself because he's a sinner just like us. There's not salvation in a sinner. There's salvation in a Savior, right? Because an ordinary man would need saving himself. Therefore, to be Savior and pay for the sins of the world, he would have to be God. Only God could do that. Right? Let's combine the next two. What he did and why I need it. It says he died for our sins according to the Scriptures. He was buried and he rose again the third day according to the Scriptures. What did he do? He died, was buried, and rose again. Why do I need it? Well, it says he died for our sins. That word for means on behalf of. He died in my place. It's where we get the idea of a substitute. I'm the guilty sinner. He took my sin upon him, the Scripture says. He died for me. I'm the one who deserved that. We're all sinners, the Bible tells us. In fact, let me show you how we can see this in reality. How many of you have children? You ever have to teach them to sin? No? Did your parents have to teach you to sin? You know, it's amazing. Every church I go to, everyone answers it the same way. I didn't have to be taught to sin either. When Adam and Eve sinned, what did they pass down to the human race? Sin. When Adam sinned, what did he pass down to his children? Sin. When you had children, what did you pass down to your children? Sin. You see? And there's only one way that a human being can be delivered from that sin. Do you see? There has to be a payment for sin. God takes sin seriously, and he's going to judge sin someday. It's going to happen. He's not just going to look the other way. He's just. And he has, in his great kindness and mercy and grace, has made a payment for sin that's sufficient. And all he asked people to do is believe that that's enough to be saved. And that leads us right to the next one, how I get it. We've seen already it's by faith. It's by believing that it's enough. And where do I find it? He says, according to the scriptures. Isn't it interesting that in this gospel passage, the only thing he says twice is according to the scriptures. What in the point of the gospel that Jesus died, was buried, and rose again the third day? Why does he say according to the scriptures here? Well, it's important. He's stating his authority. He's saying this is not from any man or church or denomination. The apostles didn't just get together, brainstorm, and come up with this. This is God's plan. This is what God says it takes to be saved. And there's not a plan B. This is it. And then finally, proclaiming the gospel. That is our mission. Do you know, it is, if you're a believer in the Lord Jesus Christ, it's your responsibility, it's my responsibility to week in and week out witness to our friends, share the gospel with our friends as best we can. In fact, let me ask you this. How many of you have at least one unbeliever in your life? Everybody does, right? You know what I want to encourage you to do? I want to challenge you to do? That person, someone immediately came to mind, I'm sure, for you. Will you start praying for them today? Here's what I'd like you to pray for them. Pray that they would hear, understand, and believe the gospel message for salvation. Will you do that? Pray that they'll hear, understand, and believe the gospel message for salvation. If you come back tonight, I'm going to show you an easy way you can start talking to them, okay? A way that's going to feel natural and simple, in a way that you can remember, all right? I hope you'll come back tonight at 5. Did you notice, in conclusion, what's not included in the gospel message? You notice Paul didn't mention any of these things. He didn't mention baptism, didn't mention joining a church, didn't mention any good deeds, didn't mention going forward an altar call or invitation, didn't mention turning over a new leaf, didn't mention any kind of prayer, didn't mention you committing your life to him, didn't mention any of that. You know why? Hebrews 9:22 says this. I encourage you to memorize this verse. Without the shedding of blood, there is no forgiveness of sins. Your version may say remission. That means forgiveness. Without the shedding of blood, there is no forgiveness of sins. Well, based on that, a lot of people believe that there are certain activities that actually save you, okay? There are two related questions that Hebrews 9:22 raises with any activity that someone says saves you. Let me show you what I mean, okay? Hebrews 9:22, without the shedding of blood, there is no forgiveness of sins. Here's the two questions. Is there the shedding of blood involved? Can there be the forgiveness of sins? Let's just take a couple here. Water baptism. Is there the shedding of blood involved in water baptism? Hopefully not, right? I mean, there's not any blood up there in the baptistry, right? No, there isn't. You know, Southern Baptist churches don't believe baptism saves you. Southern Baptist churches believe in believer's baptism. It's something a believer does. Baptism can't save because according to Hebrews 9:22, there has to be the shedding of blood involved for the forgiveness of sins. How about joining a church, right? Hopefully there's not shedding of blood involved, right? No, there isn't, so there can't be the forgiveness of sins there. And we don't teach that. How about praying a prayer, confessing Christ, doing good deeds, surrendering your life to him? Is there the shedding of blood involved with any of those things? Am I saying if you've done one of these things, you're not saved? No, I'm not. I'm not saying that. But if you believe that you have to do one of these things to be saved, yeah, that's why you don't have security, because your faith's in the wrong place. Notice one thing is repentance. Let's talk about repentance here. Repent, turn from your sin. First of all, what does that word mean in the New Testament? It's the Greek word metanoia. Again, I'm not a Greek scholar. I just looked it up. All that means is to change your mind. Some say, hey, you've got to repent of all of your sins, whatever that means, and then put your faith in Jesus and you can be saved. Let's think about this for a minute. Hang with me here. How many of you can remember all your sins from last week? How about from when you were a teenager? If you can't remember them, how can you repent of them? And what does that mean anyway? Does that mean you reform yourself and then come to faith in Jesus? If you can't remember them, but God can, and He expects you to repent of them, how can that possibly be done? You follow me? Here's what repentance means in the New Testament, to change your mind. When I see that what I have believed before believing the gospel was wrong, I change my mind and I accept that what Jesus did on the cross and His resurrection is enough by itself to give me the forgiveness of sins. When I believe, I am repenting. You see? And everybody believes something else before they believe the gospel. You have to change your mind and accept what God says is true. Do you see? And part of that is that you're a sinner in need of salvation. Right? No, God does not expect you to reform yourself. He didn't come, die on the cross, raise from the dead, and expect a commitment from you. He did it. You accept what He did, and then as a believer, He begins changing your mind on other things as you cooperate with Him. You see? How about Jesus' death on the cross? Is there the shedding of blood involved there? Yes. Is there the forgiveness of sins? Yes. In fact, that's the only place. You want to know why we say we believe Jesus is the only way of salvation? Because what He did on the cross is the only thing that can pay for your sin. It's not to win an argument or to say we're right. It's because there's a payment for sin that God's made. It's enough. And all you need to do is accept that, or you can reject it. It's up to you. But to have the forgiveness of sins, all you need to do is say, that's enough. I believe that. Right? How about you? What do you believe today? I hope that you'll believe that what Jesus did is enough. If you don't believe that today, will you at least consider that? It's worth your consideration, let me tell you. If you believe in one of these other things, listen to what my youth minister said a long time ago that I'll never forget. Eternity is a long time and it's too long to be wrong. Isn't it? I hope you believe the right thing today. Let's pray together and I'll turn it over to Brother Mike and let him close us out. Father, we're grateful to You that in Jesus You've provided everything we need. You, His death on the cross and His resurrection paid for our sin. And all You ask us to do to make that apply to our account in Your eyes is to believe that's enough to give us the forgiveness of sins. And we're grateful, Lord, that You've done that. I pray for those this morning who maybe for the first time see that their faith's in the wrong place. Lord, may they believe, may they change their mind, and believe what You say saves. And it's in what Jesus did. And we thank You for it. In Jesus' name, amen. Brother Mike?
You know, God calls us to trust Him, to follow Him, to believe Him, just as Preston shared with us this morning. So simple. In fact, the Bible says that Satan blinds us to the simplicity of the gospel. Nothing you can do to earn it. Trust your life to Christ. If you believe Him, what could be more important than following Him? I believe that's so important. Let's stand together today as we sing this song. If you, as Brother Whalen, sing the song, would you consider it? You've never trusted Christ. You've never publicly trusted Christ. You've never decided, made that decision to follow Christ, to believe in Him, what He did on the cross for you. Come this morning. Come to me right now. It's not the only way you can do it, but you can come to me and say, hey, I want to believe in Jesus. I want to say, I believe in Christ. If you've never done that, do that this morning. And let Christ have His blessing. All right?
and you can join this church from another church. You want to put your membership here. Whatever you need to do, you do it this morning as we sing this song together. Come on right now, let God have your way.
God forgave my sin in Jesus' name. I've been born again in Jesus' name, and in Jesus' name I come to you to share His love as He told us to. Freely, you have received. Freely, give. Go in my name, and because you
here to come back at 5 o'clock tonight.
Not only are we going to have some good food, some full pork sandwiches and some things like that, but we're going to have some spiritual food here. But we're going to try to help you learn how to share your faith with others without in a non-threatening or fearful way, okay? And I thank Brother Preston for the word he shared this morning, for what he's going to share with us tonight. We'll be back here ready to go at 5 o'clock. And we'll go from 5 to 7 tonight with a break in the middle, okay? Tomorrow night we'll be here for prayer at 6 o'clock. You can come, be with us, be a part of that. But we just pray over our community. Pray for God to save people. Pray for our church, for God to use us in a great and mighty way, okay? Anything else you can announce before we go? Y'all pray for the young people already here at camp. All right. Pray for Ms. Dawn. She's going to camp this week. She's way too old for that. She's been staying up till 11 o'clock at night, so she can just get used
getting ready,
to it.
Brother Mike?
Yes.
Love offer?
Yes. I wanted to get our love offering at the doors. So if y'all, Danny, would you grab our plates and stuff back there and get our people at the doors when we go out? We're going to give a love offering for our brother Preston and him. We're going to go collect some tonight too. If you're not prepared to give this morning, you want to give tonight, you can do that. And you'll get those flowers. I want to have someone at each door. You gentlemen to grab a plate. And let's get someone there to collect. Again, everything you put in this offering right now will go to Brother Preston's ministry, Sufficient Word Ministry. And so you would please give to make that happen. All right? One thing we do is help send him down the road to the next church, the next ministry. We want to do a good job for them, okay? All right, let's close in prayer. When you go out these doors, then you can again give tonight. We'll give you another opportunity to do that. Be back tonight at 5 o'clock. Father, thank you for these who've come this morning. God, we've been blessed by your word. We've been blessed, Father, to just see each other and encourage each other to worship you, Lord. Father, I pray that our worship of you today has been acceptable in your eyes. And God, that you would bring us back here tonight with a heart to learn, with a commitment to go, to make a difference in the kingdom of God. Oh, Lord, if we don't have a passion about going, Lord, and sharing, God, give us that passion. Help us to care, Lord, about those that we know and those we work with and those in our family and those who are our neighbors, that they know Jesus Christ and trust Him. Lord, we're just going to put this whole event and our future, our sharing, and our ministry into your hands and ask you to grow us. Thank you for what you're going to do. Bless Brother Preston and his ministry, Father, as they continue to do the work of the Lord. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.